Welcome to the first recording on VAT for taxation for the CTA taxation course 2019. The video is going to be on VAT, and this first recording is VAT part one. So the learning outcomes for today is to determine whether or not VAT should be levied in a transaction, which is covered by Section 6 of the VAT Act, to classify a supply, assuming that there should be VAT on it, and it's mainly covered by Sections 10, Section 11, Section 12, in a sense, and even Section 13. Would like to talk about the time of supply, which is predominantly Section 8. We would like to talk about the value of supply as well. The calculation of VAT is something that we want to cover in this lecture. After covering this, we'll deal mainly with output tax. Covering the above, we'll then move on to input tax, which is deductible against your VAT liability. So the VAT formula is made up of predominantly the output tax creating a liability, and you can get a deduction against that output tax to come up with your VAT payable or refundable. So you'll have a VAT refundable if the input tax is more than the output tax. Does this ever happen? Yes. Companies which or suppliers, taxpayers who supply zero rated items should charge VAT at a rate of 0%, but they are allowed to claim input tax. So they will have a zero output tax. That's if they are only dealing in zero rated supplies. So they'll get a zero output tax, and they can claim their input tax for all items that are eligible for an input tax claim. So in such a situation, you then have a VAT refundable. Examples are bakeries who sell mainly bread, which is a zero-rated item. But when you look at the major ingredients, such as flour, those are taxable supplies for which the VAT that would have been paid to the suppliers of flour can be deductible as input tax. So for the value-added tax, I'll start with the main section, which is Section 6. Here, I think we need to look at four key questions. We need to address the first of the four is, should we even charge VAT on a transaction? For example, if a taxpayer supplies goods or even services, the question is, should there be VAT in the first instance? Example, a vendor selling bananas at the corner of a street. Should they charge VAT or not? So there's quite a number of aspects that one needs to consider in order to come up to a conclusion that there should be VAT. So that's the first question. Should there be VAT? The second question we would need to, as a follow-up, as assuming the answer is yes in the first, the second question one would need to ask themselves is, at what rate? Is it a standard rated supply? Is it a zero rated supply? Or is it an exempt supply? So if it's a standard rated supply, it means you charge VAT at 15% on the value of supply. If it is a zero rated supply, you are charging VAT at 0%. If it's an exempt supply, it is not taxable. There is no VAT consequences to it. So that's question number two. At what rate? Question number three is, and in no particular order, three and four, The third question would be, when? What is the time at which this supply occurred? So there will be rules to guide that decision. So an example will be, assuming you are the taxpayer is a property developer, buys land, cuts it into small pieces, which is subdivided into lots or stands, sells those stands via schemes that are over more than 5 to 10 years. When is the VAT payable? Is it as the installments come through? Is it upfront? Or do we pay VAT at the end? Do we pay when we receive installments? In other words, there could be an installment, and as long as the customer has not paid it, we may or may not receive VAT. So all these questions are just trying to answer the question, when? And this is addressed by Section 8, which is about time of supply. And lastly, at what value? So I'll start with question one. Should we charge VAT? What are the things that you consider to know whether or not you should charge VAT? So section says, 6 says, they shall be charged, levied, and collected a tax, output tax, on the value of. So one would need to look at the things that, the instances when VAT should be charged. So whenever there is a supply, so it's important in your studies to go and see what the definition of supply is for VAT purposes. And believe me, this one is a very broad one. Most transactions where anything is supplied broadly, it's a supply. So whenever there is a supply of any by any registered operator, this is a new term and it's in bold. So one would need to understand what a registered operator is. And a registered operator is essentially a taxpayer that is registered with the revenue authority for tax purposes. And so unless you are a registered operator, if you supply, you can charge VAT. But if you are not a registered operator, you cannot charge output tax. There are no output tax consequences to a supply that has been made by a non-registered operator. So if the supply is made by a registered operator of goods or services, so before I go to goods or services, by the way, so as a student, go back and look at all sections that you can find that affect a registered operator in terms of defining what a registered operator is. Do you register voluntarily? Question number one. Do you register mandatorily? Question number two. And under what circumstances can you mandatorily register, and when do you voluntarily register? So registration status is driven by thresholds. When you are supplying taxable supplies that exceed 60,000 per year or expected to exceed 60,000 per annum, you must mandatorily register. But you could also be trading below that threshold but voluntarily decide to register for the benefit of enjoying deductions in terms of input tax and so on. Then it is also allowed. That is if you are supplying any taxable supplies. Remember, you could be supplying mixed, but as long as they are taxable supplies, you should then be able to voluntarily register, even if you are below the 60,000 per annum threshold. So moving on, you have supplied and you're a registered operator. The next item that we've put in bold there is, have you supplied goods or services? So this is going to be very important for you to know what goods are and what services are. The goods and services discussion can be a bit difficult where it's not very clear whether something is clearly goods or clearly services or both. So imagine a situation where a community gathers firewood from a nearby woodlot on a day-to-day basis for domestic purposes. And this firewood, it's not even cutting firewood, but just picking up sticks that will have dry twigs or sticks. And one amongst them then decides to help the community, the predominantly ladies, let's just say, and say, I have a cut, so I can pick up the sticks and bring them closer to you, and then you only collect from my cut. And from there, I can, and for that service, I can charge a fee. The question is he supplying a firewood fetching service where what he's really being paid for is for the convenience of bringing the firewood closer to the community, or is he supplying firewood itself, or both? If it's firewood, firewood are clearly goods. If it's the service and the convenience of bringing the firewood closer, then that is a service. So it's going to be very important for you to go and comprehend how goods are defined and how services are defined for you to be able to make a distinction. And the reason why this is important to distinguish between goods and services is when you start getting to classification of supplies, you may find that some services are exempt. Medical services are exempt, but medical goods may not necessarily be exempt. So it's important to know the difference between goods and services. But over and above trying to have a clear-cut demarcation between goods and services, the other reasons why you would want to know what goods are and what services are is the definitions scope out certain things from goods. So for instance, an item would ordinarily pass the general definition of goods or general understanding of what goods are, but then the VAT Act specifically scopes it out. So if I receive money, money is or are not goods. The two definitions as well, one key feature about them is for services, anything that qualifies as goods is then scoped out from the definition of a service. So for the firewood story, the fact that firewood are goods, you would then not be classifying it as a firewood service. The next important part of that definition is it has to happen on or after the fixed date. And the fixed date is merely the date in which the VAT came into effect, which is 1 January 2004. It was replacing the Sales Tax Act. And all this supply by a registered operator of goods or services after the fixed date must happen in the furtherance of trade. So it's going to be important for us to understand what trade is. And there's a whole definition of trade. I implore you to go and go through this definition, study it, to make sure you familiarize with that definition. It's got a lot of things, including recurrence, how often and how regularly is this activity occurring, is there consideration for it, is the consideration in money or not. So all those things are very important aspects of the definition, which in your assessments or examinations, there will be indicators that you need to use to take a decision on whether there was trade or not. One other important reason why you must also read through and thoroughly understand the definition of trade as defined in the Act is because there are certain things that could, or activities that could ordinarily be trade but are scoped out from the definition of trade by the VAT Act, such as hobbies. If, for instance, you love fishing and the taxpayer goes out and fishes every other Saturday but sells some of the fish to his neighbor for a profit for a consideration, that would be trade, but it's specifically excluded from the definition of trade because you're doing it as a hobby. Other instances that could be trade but are excluded is employment, where an employee receives remuneration from an employer, although it could be traced to the employee as there is a consideration for the services that he has rendered regularly within Zimbabwe, it's specifically excluded from the definition of trade. So you don't expect any VAT there when an employee offers a service for a fee to the employer. Yes, so those are the crucial aspects that need to be considered if in any supply that has happened, whenever there's a supply or an activity that involves supplying goods or services, you need to look at all those things and take a decision whether or not they should be VAT. So going back to my example, it was about a vendor at a street corner selling bananas. Should they be VAT? Is there a supply? Yes. By a registered operator? Question mark. The vendor may or may not be registered as an operator, a VAT vendor. So in that case, if he's not, the story stops. He cannot charge or levy VAT. But if he is a registered operator, which is very possible, then are there any goods or services? Bananas. Bananas are goods. And is it for the purposes of trade? Was it after the fixed date? Most likely in your examinations, it's after the fixed date, because 2004 is some 14 years ago. And therefore, issues to do with the fixed date are fast becoming irrelevant. But in this case, assume yes, they're selling their bananas now. So it is after the fixed date. And then the next question would be, is it for the purpose of trade? You'd still need to go, as I indicated earlier, to say, is this a regular activity? Are they doing it for consideration, whether or not for profit? But is it for a consideration, and so on and so on? And most of those answers tick the boxes, and it's a yes, yes, yes. Is it employment income? No, therefore it's not excluded. Is it a hobby? No, so it's not excluded. Is it a transfer between one branch to a foreign branch? No. So is it as an exempt supply? No. So in that case, you are persuaded to say there should be VAT levied. And at this stage, you would then prepare to move on to question two, to say at what rate. Question three, what's the time of supply? Question four, what's the value of supply? So this is the first circumstances under which there should be VAT levied. Another circumstance under which VAT should be levied and collected is whenever goods are imported. Whenever goods are imported, there is an import tax which increases the output tax liability. This is different from part A, where it's the supplier invoicing to a client and collecting the VAT. In this case, the supplier is foreign. They are not registered as an operator in our tax jurisdiction or in our country. So it is Zimra who then collect from the customer who is a resident at the border. So at ports of entry, goods and commodities must then be registered and VAT is levied for as long as they are taxable goods. So this is very important and is governed by Section 61B and Section 12 of the VAT Act. It's important, it's incumbent upon you to go and read Section 12 of the VAT Act and go through it. Your examples will require a lot of rigor in terms of how to then calculate the rate will not change, but how to calculate the value of the supply and in that case it brings a difference, because the value of supply is one that includes value for duty purposes plus the duty. So with the supply of imported services, that's the third circumstance under which there shall be VAT. Now, imported services are different from imported goods in that you cannot use the port of entry to enforce the administration of the collection of that VAT. With goods are physical, so you can You can isolate them and ensure that VAT is paid. With imported services, the person, the taxpayer rendering the service has not yet rendered the service at the time they're entering into the country. So there are four key things that one needs to look at. First, there must be a foreign supplier of a service. The supplier of the service must be a foreigner. Secondly, the recipient of the service must be a local or a resident. The recipient of the service must be a resident or a local. Third, the service that the foreigner wants to supply to the local must be in itself taxable, a taxable supply. And lastly, the local recipient of the service intends or wants to use the service from the foreigner to make non-taxable supplies. So these are four important aspects. You will be required to go into detail and look at Section 13, which governs this aspect of imported service. Once it satisfies that, what must then happen is the local recipient of the service must then be responsible and account for the VAT on the imported service. The fourth thing, circumstances, fourth circumstance under which VAT should be raised is where goods are sold at an auction, through an auctioneer by a non-registered operator. Under such circumstances, VAT must be raised. So, to capital with the imported goods, the goods must be for consumption in Zimbabwe. The import VAT will be to the extent that they are not exempt supplies. You simply take your tax rate, which is 15% in our case, and multiply it by the value for tax purposes. The value for tax purposes is the sum of the value for duty purposes plus the duty. The value or for duty purposes is your cost, insurance, and freight. Whereas with imported services, as alluded to earlier on, the services must be used to make non-taxable supplies for the VAT to be levied to them. Section 2 defines what imported services are, but over and above Section 2, you also have your Section 13. The value of supply, though, of an imported service is the greater of the open market value or the invoice value of the service. And the VAT is payable by the recipient of the service. With the goods sold through an auctioneer, the owner of goods of the goods being sold through an auction must not be, may not be a registered operator. The focus on such a transaction is, as the auctioneer is only an agent. So we need to know what an auctioneer is, and an auctioneer means a registered operator carrying on a trade which comprises or includes the supply by him by auction or by sale of goods and services as an auctioneer or agent for or on behalf of another person. And as in the case of Section 61A, which I had not mentioned earlier, Section 61A and Section 61D excludes the supply of second-hand motor vehicles.